let's just talk about this. You made a piece in response to Ta-Nehisi Coates' piece in The Atlantic about President Obama. And his story is entitled "My President Was Black," and it's a really he's a great writer. It's worth reading.
Right.
But you do raise a something that Ta-Nehisi Coates does not really seem to in any way contemplate, and that is the foreclosure crisis that we had in this country, that in many respects Obama aided insofar as did not implement any real meaningful programs to address the foreclosure crisis head on.
Right. And I wanted to get into that is how this had a disproportionate impact on people of color, which is something we know from the statistical analysis. If you look at the Federal Reserve's survey of consumer finances, they show that the racial wealth gap, it expanded in the Obama years, and that was largely due to foreclosures. Ta-Nehisi Coates mentions the racial wealth gap, but he doesn't mention that it expanded under Obama. And when you look into it, that the reasons why, you just can't escape the fact that this was due to, you know, creating a foreclosure mitigation program that didn't mitigate foreclosures, that responding to the largest consumer fraud in American history, this false document scandal where people were engaging in foreclosures under false pretenses with fake evidence. Responding to that with no sanctions for the people involved and very little meaningful relief for homeowners to reallocate those losses. You have to come to the conclusion that Obama has some culpability here for this very dramatic disintegration of wealth for African-American and Latino families. Brad Miller, who I don't know if he's been on your program, but he was the former congressman who was credited with co-authoring the legislation that became the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. He has called this an extinction event for the black and Latino middle class. That's what he's called the foreclosure crisis. And we've gone over talking, me and you, about the myriad ways in which the Obama administration, put their thumbs on the scale in protection of bank balance sheets, but not in protection of homeowner balance sheets. And I just thought, I've seen all of these legacy pieces about the administration and what Obama meant, and none of them wrestle with this part of his legacy, which is part of his legacy. I mean, it's inescapable. You cannot completely talk about who this president was and what he meant without noting that when people of color and millions of American homeowners really needed his leadership, that they didn't get it.
And let's be clear that obviously Obama's not responsible for the financial crisis, but the ongoing, the 9+ million families who lost their homes, he could not have necessarily saved those each one of those homes. But there were many different moments where he made a fundamental decision that was contrary to providing direct relief to these people. I mean,
absolutely. And this is all in this piece and, practically everything I've written in the last 6 years. This was a policy and there were distinct policy choices made. There were promises made at the beginning of the Obama administration. We're going to put $100 billion towards foreclosure mitigation. 8 years later, $20 billion has been spent. we're going to modify 4 million loans. 8 years later, barely 1 million of these modifications are still active, and about 40% of them have failed. We were going to, on the campaign trail, Obama said, we promise we're going to change the bankruptcy laws to allow bankruptcy judges to modify loans for primary residence mortgages. And then his economic team whipped against that when it came up for a vote.
That was the cram down. That was the first sign, yeah. I think, in 2009. I mean, I remember that vividly because that was the first moment where there was some of us emo progs at the time saying, hey, wait a second, this is a problem. But let me finish. Let me just end this with one quote from your piece, because as I hear stories of, and this is a good segue into what I'm going to be talking about in the next part of the show, but as I hear stories, we heard some of this last night with Bernie Sanders, or two nights ago, the town hall with Trump voters, where they said, well, we don't really think Trump's going to do that stuff about the Muslim registry, or that that piece in Vox about the county in Kentucky that voted against Obamacare, but we're like, well, we don't think he's going to take away, we just think he's going to do what's right, projecting upon Trump these sort of notions without sort of really contemplating the implications of a completely controlled Congress. I think this quote at the end here is really where the real damage has come. You write, Coates squarely blames racism for the rise of Trump, but the destruction of faith in institutions also plowed that pathway. Obama sapped the faith when he could have restored it, and now his party, the one that believes government can act to protect its citizens, is at its lowest ebb in 90 years. I think there's a lot across the board, not just with these voters, but I think with a lot of different voters, that dynamic, I think, made this election far closer than it should have been. And that, mixed with a couple other factors, made it one that the outcome was not predictable.
Right.
David Dayan, thanks so much for your time today, buddy. I always appreciate it.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, it's Sam Cedar. Why don't you subscribe to this channel? You can do so right over here. Subscribe.